We'll continue. Item 5 on the agenda. Research and development of Chinese medicine. Let's invite the administration team to come in. We'll wait for the commissioner to come back. This is an item on research and development of Chinese medicines. Lechko has received this paper from the administration, and that is CB bracket 1/10/45 bracket 07, and the secretariat has also updated the background brief which has been distributed. That's paper 1045 bracket 08. When the commissioner comes back, we'll have an introduction of the administration team appearing for this item. We have, of course, Ms. Annie Choi and also Dr. Cecilia Pang, Biotechnology Director of the Commission, Mr. Keeson Lee, Secretary General of the Hong Kong Council for Testing and Certification. We also have Mr. Joanne Wong, Deputy Commissioner, Mrs. Millie Kang, Deputy Secretary, and also Mr. Robert Law, Senior Pharmacist of the Department of Health. Okay? We welcome you. Who will take us through the paper? Chairman. Every 2 years, we'll come back to the panel to report to members our work in R&D of CM. This is a report on our work since June 2014. In terms of R&D, there are a few aspects. Number one, the ITF supports research in different projects. First, it has to do with R&D of CM, testing and accreditation, and also the technology side, and the production side, and that is the GMP, good manufacturing practice. This has to do with training and exchange, technology support and information exchange within the industry, and also we like to promote our work to the sector and the community. Every year, we hold a seminar, which is highly popular with the CM sector. We have been asked to continue with it. At the seminar, we will talk about R&D of CM, including technology, and we will update the industry of new developments around the world. These are the main thrusts of our work in the coming 2 years, and we expect to continue in these few aspects.
We will continue to work hard and work with the industry to see in the field of R&D and technology what sort of support they require, and we will continue to provide such support. Thank you. Dr. Angel, my name is Jiang Laiwan. Thank you, Chairman. I also have a question for the Director. Regarding the standards for traditional Chinese herbal medicine, so how many jurisdictions have recognized our standard for traditional Chinese herbal medicine? I'll ask our colleagues from the Department of Health to answer the question. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jiang. The Hong Kong standard, when we built this standard, an international panel of experts already provided us with the support. These experts came from Europe, the UK, and even the United States. More importantly, the mainland is also strongly in support of our work in this area. Our certification, I think we've said, promoted this through different channels, and is now being recognized. For example, on the WHO website, under the section of traditional medicine, where our standard is already, CMM standard is already accepted and is also made available for the reference of the industry. We also have many collaborating partners. For example, there is a forum on herbal medicine, and this organization also accept our CMM standard. So in terms of promotion, I think our standard has been widely recognized. For health supplements, there are many health supplements manufactured in the mainland, which are exported to other parts of the world through Hong Kong. For such health supplements which are exported to other countries, are there any which use our Hong Kong CMM standards? I think our CMM standards basically focus on the herbal ingredients in these health products, such as ginseng. In the process of manufacturing such products, the manufacturer will adopt our standard to ensure that they will not exceed the threshold for pesticides and so on, so that quality products can be manufactured and exported overseas. We heard from the Department of Food and Health that in our industrial estate, they are planning to build a certification and testing center. Will you continue to step up the effort on the Hong Kong CMM standards? I think you're right, Dr. Jiang. The department and the bureau are now working on a TCM testing and center. The site selected is the Science and Technology Park. This center will continue to carry on with the work regarding the Hong Kong CMM standards. And the center should be able to help the industry to manufacture traditional Chinese herbal health supplements, and to help the industry enhance the standards so that we can promote these products overseas. And this is one of the important tasks of the testing center for the Hong Kong CMM standards compared with the standards in the mainland. Are they basically the same, and are they equally recognized internationally? I think the Hong Kong CMM standards and the Chinese pharmacopoeia, I think, of course, we would make reference of the Chinese, standard. For example, in terms of safety, we will focus more on heavy metals and residues of pesticides. We will have more thorough control on each and every herbal medicine. For the Chinese standards, they will define safety standards for individual herbal medicine, but not for all herbal medicine. We know that to promote our proprietary TCM products, we need to really, you know, adhere to very strict standards. We would have standards for each and every, product. In terms of quality control, the technology that we use would be more varied. For example, we'll use DNA technology. For the Chinese Pharmacopoeia 2015, they've also drastically enhanced the standard. And they've also, I understand that very often when we, develop a new market, our products would need to satisfy the local standard in that market. For these health supplements, which are manufactured in Hong Kong and exported to the mainland, do we need to also comply with the mainland standards, would the mainland recognize our standard? Because of the one country, two system scenario, we have our registration system, and the mainland, they also have the registration system, even for Western medicine. So, as far as the registration system is concerned, we don't have any mutual recognition arrangement, and it's the same for other countries. So far, different countries have their own registration system for medical products, so we are not able to have mutual recognition yet. Now, in that case, in Hong Kong, there are many such health supplement products in the market. Some, I understand, are not even registered with your department, but nevertheless, they are sold in drugstores. How are you going to supervise them? For such products sold in Hong Kong, do they need to comply with our standards? We are also aware of that. There are three ordinances that would regulate the products sold in the market. First of all, the TCM ordinance. We are responsible for the registration of traditional Chinese medicine. Secondly, the Department of Health will supervise the registration of pharmaceutical products, which can only be sold after they have been registered. If certain medicine claims that it can cure certain diseases, it would be regarded as a pharmaceutical product and have to be registered. For many products, if they fall within this category, then they are covered by the Pharmacy and Poisons Ordinance. Thirdly, there are some products which are sold as food products. I don't know too much about this ordinance, but it is enforced by the FVHD. So through the existing ordinances, we hope we'll be able to, apply different ordinances to regulate the sale of these products. Now, if people sell the products in Hong Kong, they should satisfy our standards, because if we export our products to other markets, we also have to satisfy their standards. I'm not pressing you for an answer, but I think this is something that deserves to be explored. I hope that you will discuss with Beijing to see whether or not we can have a sort of mutual recognition, which will benefit both sides, actually. Why don't you talk to them and asked the CE to take up the issue when he goes to Beijing and tell the Beijing authorities that we need the mutual recognition. Because that way, all the drug manufacturers in Hong Kong will really appreciate that. I think our standard now is even more stringent than theirs. So I understand that the Science and Technology Park is now working on this, and they've been already allocated a site. So I really encourage that you would go for mutual recognition. Director, I have another question. Earlier on, we were working on GMP. Many manufacturers said that they have to close down and that the government is stifling these 100-year-old factories or businesses. So what is the latest situation? Director? Chairman, the GMP regulation is about quality assurance. If you can satisfy the GMP requirements, of course, that would be ideal. And we always encourage GMP. And that's why in the document we say that we provide a lot of training and technical support. At the moment, there are many Chinese medical manufacturers of Chinese medicine which are found sites in our industrial estate to build GMP factories. For the smaller manufacturers, which cannot, use up an entire site, and yet they want to comply with the standard. Earlier, at the FC, we were allocated funding to build in the industrial estate an advanced, production manufacturing complex. And we hope that going forward, we will not be allocating, sites which can only be taken up by large companies. We will build a complex which is designed in a flexible and efficient manner so that individual manufacturers from whatever industries, including the TCM industry, if they think they cannot use a very large site, they could lease instead a portion of a site, say half a floor or a small area, which they can use to set up a small GMP facility. I think that can be considered. Of course, it's up to the manufacturers to talk to the Hong Kong Science and Technology Park. Now that we have this model, in other words, you don't need to take up an entire site. And with this new model and with funding approved by LegCo, the industries can consider this option. The new and high efficiency complex will have, for example, clean rooms available. So the manufacturers can decide on the size of the area they would need instead of taking up a whole site. With that flexibility, the TCM manufacturers can consider this option together with our other GMP training and technical support. I think we would be able to resolve the problem. How many manufacturers are now using your central GMP? There are 50 or so at the biotech institute. They are doing contract manufacturing. They're using the facility, the TCM facility there. I hope the department will really support those manufacturers. They are well-established businesses, but they've never been able to expand. And now they will ask them to build a GMP facility, and the investment required is so large that they can't afford it. I think they're now changing the model. According to my contact with the TCM petitioners, they are just worried that the formula would be leaked outside. If the government can ensure that the formula would not be leaked out, it's certainly viable for them. In the past, we couldn't guarantee the quality of TCM products, and that was a major concern. But many of the proprietary formula, they don't want it to be shared or leaked out. I think the government will have to give them confidence. Chairman, I'm suddenly reminded of one question.
Sorry. What?
You still have 5 minutes. Supposing now there is a manufacturer on the mainland, he takes a product for you to test, and after testing, you will issue a certificate. Sorry, this is my mobile phone. I shouldn't use it as an example. You will, of course, list the active ingredients and whatnot. Then can he say that his medicine has been tested and accredited by Hong Kong according to Hong Kong standards with active ingredients making up a certain percentage? Can he do that? Or does that product have to be processed in Hong Kong, at least in part? Let me talk about proprietary medicine, like a bottle of tablets. No, do you remember this example? The FDA of the US was featured on the mainland, but in fact only testing was done by the FDA. However, when you do the manufacturing, we don't know what ingredients you put into the product. Will that happen in Hong Kong? Regarding the registration system, it is not easy for a product to make such claims. In the registration process, usually we will not allow the use of such wording. Apart from the English alphabet GMP, if it is proved that the product is made by a GMP manufacturer, because the standard of the GMP manufacturer has been accredited, whether it is in Hong Kong or on the mainland, if a certificate can be provided, then we can allow it to be printed. But publicity wording like FDA approval, usually that will not be allowed. Well, think about this. If the last step is done in Hong Kong, and if it is exported from Hong Kong, then it's good because it will help Hong Kong's GDP. Hong Kong has money. We can certainly plow more money into testing and accreditation and the testing for composition, so that we can have better CMM. I think that will be good and I will support it, but we have to attract more people to use our services. We have some at the Science Park. You can say, come here, we will do it at a low price, and then they will be able to use the certificate for publicity. It's good that we provide service to other people, but we have to be mindful of our industrial development. I think Chinese medicine has a good prospect in Hong Kong. Have you gone to the Science Park? Basically, we have completed the siting stage, and we are now entering the renovation stage. With regard to the temporary siting, we believe we can have occupation at the beginning of next year. Chairman, can you take us for a site visit? I don't know whether I will be the chairman. No, as representatives of the business sector, we can go there. Maybe you and I may not be here, but as members of the business community, we can go there for a visit. Okay, thank you. If there are no other questions, we thank the officials for attending for this item. We have a tight agenda today because this is our last meeting. I have to keep the time. Thank you for coming. Next item, diversified development of industries in Hong Kong. Welcome, Ms. Chen Yun-Han. Chairman, before reunification, we looked into the development of Chinese medicine. Right, we said there should be a Chinese medicine hub set up in Hong Kong. But I entered the room in the middle of the discussion and hearing from Ms. Anne Chang, in fact, I don't see that happening. In fact, I would like to watch the progress. It's a pity that I will not be back. Is it that the administration team has arrived for the next item? We welcome you. We have advanced the item. Attending for this item, we have Mr. Godfrey Leung, Undersecretary for CED, Mrs. Alice Chung, DS for CED, Mr. Jerry Liu, Head of Create Hong Kong, Ms. Emily Mo, Assistant Commissioner for Tourism, Mr. Ricky Chong, PAS for INT, Mr. Francis Leung, PAS for Development, Ms. Candy Nip, PAS for Transport and Housing, and Ms. Mary Zhang, PAS for Transport and Housing. Welcome. The administration has provided a discussion paper for this item, and that is CB bracket 1, 1045, bracket 09. Can I ask the administration now to present the paper, please? Mr. Leung. Thank you, Chairman. The government attaches great importance to the diversified development of industries so as to meet the needs of Hong Kong people and for startup initiatives, investment and business operation, and to provide choices for employment. We'd like to expand and deepen the advantages of the pillar industries to preserve our competitiveness and to support the development of emerging industries in order to diversify and fortify the economic base. In order to map out the relevant directions, the EDC was set up in 2013 under the leadership of the CE. The EDC has been studying how to make use of Hong Kong's prevailing advantages and opportunities, conducting examination on the overall strategy and policy to broaden our economic base and enhance our long-term development, and also to identify industries with present opportunities for Hong Kong's further economic growth. There are four working groups under the EDC on convention and exhibition industries and tourism, manufacturing industries, innovative technology and cultural and creative industries, professional services and transportation. They have been discussing ways to promote the development of relevant industries and have gradually submitted recommendations on the policies and the measures. And they have been endorsed by the EDC and they have been accepted by government, and the government is now progressing to implement them. The relevant recommendations and also the diversification of industries, these have been contained in the paper for members' scrutiny. And now I'd like to give the gist of the paper to members. Convention and exhibition industries and tourism. It is suggested that there should be more reception capacity for Hong Kong so that we can bring in high-value added visitors. In terms of MICE, we have already completed a consultancy study, and at the beginning of 2015, there has been the presentation to this panel as to what follow-up action has been done. When the convention station on the Sha Tin Central Link is completed, there will be the building of a convention center, and the TDC has been invited to do a design for the center. On the other hand, in terms of INT and also creative industries, the EDC has looked into the potential for development of these industries. In terms of INT, the working group proposes to expand the scope of support of the ITF, and this has been accepted. And it has now covered downstream R&D and product transformation. And it is said that there should be more support to private enterprises. And because of such proposals, the Science Park and also the Cyberport would be looking at supporting more incubation programs. As for creative industries, the EDC has looked at the support of some industries with an advantage, and these have been accepted by government and they are being implemented. And we would be adding the quota to Hong Kong Young Design Talent Award, and there would be more opportunity. Sorry, Undersecretary, can you please stop for a while? We have to vote in another room. We'll have to suspend the meeting. We will resume in a moment.